Good morning. Welcome to Madison Church. I'm so glad that I get to worship together with you today. This would be a strange day to be a visitor to Madison Church or to just not know about the loss our church family suffered this week. Our brother Tim Siemens passed away on Thursday, and he's our longtime elder here at our church, an all-around servant, and always our sound man. And we're going to miss him a lot. So if you catch us shedding some tears, you'll know why. By way of announcements, I only have that next week at 6 p.m. at my house, we're going to get our youth group together. And that's exciting for me because it's been since October. And I can't wait to see you guys again. And I'm really excited about that. Before we go now to a time of prayer in our service, I want to open with a passage from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. There we read, "Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words."
As we come to prayer time, there is so much to pray about today. But I want to focus on eternal life. Let's just go to God in prayer. Our dear and heavenly Father, we've lost a brother in Christ. Our hearts are wounded. We're sad. But give us the confidence in Christ that Tim had. Give us the confidence that there is a resurrection to a new and joyful life with our eternal Father. Let the Holy Spirit come among us today to strengthen that love like Tim had. Tim worked every day as a disciple for Christ, always knowing that the end of this worldly life, the Spirit would have eternal life with his Holy Father, where all tears will be wiped away. Lord, we live in an angry world, a world that's divided, a world that is oppressing the church, not only in the world, but also here in this country. We pray that today that the Holy Spirit will come amongst not just us, but will spread across the world so that other people will know and share the joy in knowing Jesus that we have. We pray that you will be with the Siemens family. Be with them and know that we will be there for encouragement and support whenever needed, not just because we're asked to, because it's the right thing to do. It's a Christian thing to do. Lord, we pray that you will be with the brothers and sisters of Tim and Diane, that we will continue to lift them up in our prayers daily. Lord, we ask at this time that we look more towards the joy of knowing Jesus, the joy that Tim is feeling at this time, knowing that he will be returned to the lost loved ones that went before him. We pray that we will have that same kind of attitude. These things we ask for in Jesus' name. Amen.
So good to see you guys this morning. Done a lot of singing this week and just a lot of time of reflection. So Why don't you guys go ahead and stand up, and we're just going to worship the Lord together this morning.
Thank you. Wait.
As we enter this time for communion, the early Christians, we read in the scripture, they met to break bread, have communion, sing praise the first day of the week. So let's go to the Lord in prayer. Our dear Heavenly Father, O Lord, how we need you at this time. As we take the communion today, let us be mindful that the communion is a gift from you. That we think upon the broken body of Christ and the shed blood as we take of the bread and the fruit of the vine. Lord, let us be mindful of our own selves. Let us ask, O Lord, we need you. Help guide us. Bring the Holy Spirit with us to help us through each day. In Jesus' name, amen.
Today, offering time, we just wanted to sing a song. I found this song about a month ago. And like I said, music's been very therapeutic for me, and I know for many of us. So, we'll just sing it for you.
And I will take heart, 'cause you
We're going to take a break from our Faith Under Attack series this week. Instead, I want us to look at a psalm together. We're going to turn to Psalm 13. I'd like you to open there with me, or you can, it's also printed on the inside of your bulletin. You can follow along there. In this passage this morning, we're going to look for something that I know I needed desperately this week. I think this passage supplies us some resource for help trusting God. I'm suspicious that you might need this direction as well as I. By the time we're done, I hope not only to show you the reason to trust God, but also, in a practical dimension, the way in which you can train your heart and your soul to do so. Our passage is a psalm, which is a prayer, one that would be set to music. This one is a psalm of David. David was Israel's king, and he wrote many of the psalms, both during the time when he was the king of Israel and even before he was king of Israel, when he was either in service to or running from Saul, the king who preceded him. We're not told the setting for this psalm. Sometimes we are. We're told what situation in David's life led to these words, or we can find clues in the text itself to tell us, but in a way I think this is helpful because we can't write off these words that we're going to read here in Psalm 13 as belonging to some circumstance that we didn't go through, right? So if we're told that these were the words of David when he was running away from Saul, or when his family and his men's families were kidnapped, you know, we would be able to say, well, I didn't live through that. These words aren't for me. But as we turn to this psalm, as we begin to read, it will be apparent that David is coming from a place of personal anguish in this prayer, that he is having a hard time. He is struggling to find peace. Possibly David is in a moment like the one that we're experiencing as a church family today. So let's begin reading in verse 1 of Psalm 13. We read there, "How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me?" Do you get a sense for David's despair? There's sorrow in his heart, thoughts he must wrestle with, a feeling of defeat, and even a sense of estrangement from God. Which of us has not known a moment like this? Moments like this come in your life. If you live maybe past adolescence, you will have one or many. It could be from the death of a friend or a loved one. It could be from a trial that you live through, a hardship like poverty or debt, health problems, relational failure or stress, sometimes just a sense of malaise or lostness. Over and over again in life, we face these challenges to our souls, these obstacles to joy and fulfillment, and worst of all, these moments challenge the way that we feel about God. These moments can make us wonder and doubt for a moment whether or not God does love and care for us. David is facing a moment like this. And I want you to pay attention to the question that he asks four times here in these two verses that we read. Four times he asks, "How long?" This is the correct question, I think, from David to ask when you're struggling, when you're suffering and praying to God. I think it is superior to the other one that we have a tendency to ask God when things are going wrong. What naturally comes to our tongue from our hearts when we're suffering and when we're asking God about it? We normally are used to asking the question, why? Why, God, are you letting me suffer? Why are you letting me go through this? Why is a fair question. But it's important to know that it's one with a trustworthy answer in God's Word. It's not one we have to be left in suspense over. God has given us the answer. God's word tells us that death, pain, loss, and suffering are all a result of our choice to sin. All a result of the legacy of sin among mankind. We, people, were given the freedom to choose by our Creator, that we might be capable of worship and love, personhood, and relationships. We were given these incredible abilities to make choices, a mobility of will, and that gift came with the possibility of evil, the possibility that we might sin against God. And that is the course we have chosen. It is the course that Adam and Eve chose in the Garden of Eden. And so we, each time we sin against God, ratified the decision that they have made. Thus we have no reason to hold a grudge against God when we share in their punishment. When we choose to reject God and suffer death, God did not reverse our choice. When we made the choice to live in a way other than what He designed us for, God didn't just undo the decision we made. He didn't take away our freedom or our self-determination. Instead, our loving God subjected His creation to frustration, to mortality, to accommodate our rebellion, and began working on a way that we might be saved from this curse that we had pulled over ourselves. He began working on a way to provide for us to be saved from it through the blood of His Son, Jesus Christ. So there is an answer to why. Asking why is a fair question, but there is an answer to it. We suffer, we experience pain, we have these intense moments of loss and sadness because of sin, universally. Because of the choice we have made to reject God's bountiful and perfect creation and live in disobedience to Him. When we observe this, when we see that death is not God's instrument. Death is God's enemy. God is not pleased by our mortality. God is heartbroken over it. And He sent His Son, Jesus, to rescue us from it. Thus, the most important question that we can ask when we're suffering is not why. We know the answer. But the important question to ask is how long? How long until the victory over death is finally realized in God's eternal kingdom? How long until the victory pronounced on Easter morning is brought to earth where we currently suffer? How long until we see our friends and loved ones resurrected in the city of God? You see, our victory and our deliverance from pain and suffering are certain in Jesus Christ. As certain as a sunrise. What we are not certain of is when it will arrive. What we are not certain of is in what hour we will hear the trumpet call and the voice of the archangel. We're not certain when Christ will return to judge the earth and establish His kingdom forever. So see the prayer of David here, and see what he asks God for in his suffering, and in your sadness, in your mourning, change your whys to how longs. Reading on in verse 3 of Psalm 13, we find these words of David. He says, "Look on me and answer, Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. And my enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall." Here we see David making his request to God, a request for strength and blessing. He says, answer me, give light to my eyes. See, God was kind to David. God provided David with many blessings. But it's important to note, it's important to see that David was not spared from all pain. David buried some of his children. David was betrayed by advisors. David was driven from his home as an exile in a rebellion. David was shunned by a wife who was made barren. David's family and all of his fighting men were kidnapped. God let him suffer all of those terrible things, despite the fact that David asked many times in passages like this, all throughout the Psalms, to be spared from them. It's important to see that David knew all too well a truth that we were reminded of poignantly this month. God does not answer all of our prayers to be spared from pain with yes. Let me just clarify two truths here. That when we pray and ask God to be spared from pain, when we ask Him for healing and it does not come, one, it is not the fault of the prayer every time that our prayers go unanswered. David was a man after God's own heart. He was the best prayer of them all. Here we are in church in 2021 reading a prayer of David. That's how good he was at it. And yet he was not spared life's pains. He was not spared death itself. It came for him like it will come for you and I. God instructs us to offer our prayers in faith, and we do so trusting Him. After you have done so, you don't need to wonder if your prayer was insufficient or left any measure of blessing on the table, because it was the Holy Spirit who spoke to God on your behalf, and there was nothing insufficient about it. The most righteous and earnest prayers that we pray may be answered no. That's not because God is cruel or uncaring. He is not deaf to your prayer. It's because God has seen our lives from beginning to end. God knows our destiny, and He knows the number of our days. God knows what is best for each of His creatures and all of His creation together as a whole. Two, I want you to know that it is not God's will for us to suffer pain, nor for our loved ones to die. God's word shows us that death is God's enemy, an invader to God's creation, chosen by mankind over what God had made us to be. God is in the business of rescuing us from death. He is not the undertaker. And though God knows the hour and moment when each of us will breathe our last breath, although He knows that, I think there is a degree of error in saying that anyone's death was God's will or that God decided to take them. Such colloquialisms make death out to be a friend or instrument of God, when ultimately, according to His word, it is His enemy. Ultimately, God's will for us is not to die. God's will for you is not death, but to live eternally. And those who have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ will see His will fulfilled in the eternal kingdom of our God. That brings us to the final verses of Psalm 13, verses 5 and 6, where we read this: "But I trust in Your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in Your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for He has been good to me." Don't those verses sound different than the first four? Despite David's dark and desperate situation, he trusts God. You see that? David trusts God because he knows who God is, unfailing love. David trusts God because he knows what God will do for him, ultimately, salvation. And his response to this knowledge, even in the midst of suffering, even though he feels estrangement from God, and even though he feels saddened and disheartened, is praise. "I will sing the Lord's praise." We are to trust God like David, not to save us from every pain and sadness. That is not what God offers. It's important to understand that God The reason why we don't receive this is because God has given mankind the gift of free will, of self-determination, and we have used it to sin. For God to take away the consequences of those sins, of that choice, that would mean that we were never free in the first place. So God does not save us from every pain and sadness. That is not what he offers, but we trust God because we know that he loves us, and we know that he has saved us through his Son, Jesus Christ, that we might overcome death as he has done. But hear me this morning when I tell you that possessing and living this trust through life's hard times, through life's darkest hour, is not easy. It's not easy, and it doesn't come naturally to our sinful heart. Trusting God through life's dark times and even into life's darkest hour is something you have to learn. It can be hard to find comfort and peace in your soul when you're suffering tragedy and when you're facing death. So how do you do it? How do you train your heart and your soul to trust God? How do you trust his unfailing love and rejoice in his salvation in the darkest times, even when death comes for you? You do it here. You learn to trust God by turning your eyes to God's word. You learn to trust God by lifting up God's name in praise. You do it by every week of your life, gathering together with your brothers and sisters in Christ to do these things together. To taste the body and blood of Christ's sacrifice, which rescued us from sin, together as a church family. To proclaim the goodness of our God together in song. To read the promises of God's word for life beyond death. To hear these promises and to proclaim amen with your brothers and sisters. We gather in this room every Sunday morning, not to check a box, not to clear our guilt, and not just to praise our mighty and loving God. But when we gather here, we train our hearts and our minds and our souls to trust God. The things that we do in this room are training our hearts to accept these truths, to trust in them, so that when we face challenges and darkness and sadness and even death, when we're not here together, we will have the trust in God that we need to do it with confidence and peace. We do this training together with the support of our brothers and sisters in this room who sing with us, who bring food to potlucks, and learn God's word together with us in Sunday school, and share our faith with each other. Here's the truth. Someday you will face life's greatest challenge, its end. Someday you will stand on death's door. In our future, for each of us, is likely some scary doctor's appointments where the test results aren't good and the news is pretty bad. There is no substitute for the strength that you will have in that moment, which you will have acquired by training your heart together with God's people on Sunday morning to trust God's goodness and his salvation. Tim went through quite an ordeal this month. But Tim had been training his heart and his soul to trust God. He'd been training himself to do this his entire life, every Sunday, meeting together with God's people to absorb God's word, to let the promise of eternal life for the redeemed in Jesus Christ soak down into his bones, to lift up praises to God, most of the time in this very room together with us. Tim was raised in the faith, and he has been worshiping our Lord for as long as he's had a voice. One you may have heard from the balcony carrying the bass line on a hymn. In doing so, Tim trained his heart and his soul to trust God. So Tim faced these moments, these incredibly trying and sad moments of the last month with a confidence and a peace that he had acquired over many decades in this room together with you. I spoke with Tim on Thursday, and you could hear it in his voice as he proclaimed it with his lips. Do you trust God that much? Do you trust him now in this moment of grief, where we feel Tim's loss so harshly? Do you possess in your soul the strength to face your own death in confidence? Or could you use a little more practice? I can tell you, your preacher needs the practice. That my soul and my heart need a little more training. That's why next Sunday I'll be right here back with you, lifting up God's name in praise, turning my attention to God's word and praying together with you. I hope to see you there. Let's pray. Dear God, our hearts are broken today. But we come to you in this moment trusting. Trusting in your goodness and your salvation, and knowing that our brother Tim carried that trust with him. Dear God, our question to you is how long we will have to suffer sadness and heartaches like this one. God, won't you return in victory to deliver us from our pain once and for all? Won't you reunite us with Tim and our loved ones who have preceded us in death? Dear God, see our sadness and deliver us from it. Strengthen our weak hearts and show us your love. We know that you love us and your love is unfailing. We trust the salvation you've given us through Jesus, your Son and our Lord. So we lift up your name in praise together that we may never forget. Amen.
Would you stand and sing with us as we close?
Just to rest upon
you next time.